Good morning and welcome to the Center for Spiritual Living in the heart of Las Cruces, where your center is alive and well in all of our hearts, and where our vision is a world in loving partnership for the good of all. I'm Reverend Bonnie, the community spiritual leader here at the center, and I'm reminding everyone that we still have our weekly Wednesday morning discussion group called A Spiritual Circle. It's at 11 o'clock over Zoom. They're also interested in knowing if you would like to have another spiritual circle at a different time. So if you would, please call the office and let us know what times and day work for you. Our 2021 spiritual journals are on sale. They're 20% off, so only $12. The journals were created to be a place where you could write notes about the Sunday services, ahas, and ideas and thoughts, and keep track as you move through the year with us. The bookstore is open here at the center by appointment, so just call the office if you'd like to come in and purchase a journal or anything else out of the bookstore. Our newsletter is also filled with opportunities to join in workshops and events online and join in with the greater New Thought community around the country. And all of that information, like I said, is in the newsletter, so check that out as well. And if you need to be added to the newsletter email list, please call the office and they will gladly add you. Practitioner Teresa Valenzuela is facilitating the Association for Global New Thought Season for Nonviolence weekly discussion and meditation via Zoom, and that will start Sunday, January 31st through April 4th from 1 to 2 in the afternoon. We fully believe in the principle of circulation and prosperity, and therefore we are a tithing community. This month, 10% of all that we receive through our tithes and offerings are being tithed to the Aggie Cupboard. The mission of the Aggie Cupboard is to provide free supplementary food assistance to the New Mexico State University community, including Las Cruces and the Doñana Community College students, faculty, and staff. They strive to create an atmosphere of care, concern, and support for those who may be struggling with food insecurity. The Aggie Cupboard works to educate on the prevalence of food insecurity and hunger experiences by the NMSU community. Thank you so much for all that you contribute so we can contribute to these other folks in our community. Our speakers and practitioners in service today are our emeritus practitioners, Doug and Tina Bailey. The Baileys have been members of the center since the mid-80s. Tina and Doug met in Las Cruces in the early 80s and have been practitioners and served here at our center since the mid-90s. Doug and Tina taught a number of classes together. They formed and administered a prosperity club, are consistent members of our weekly prayer team, and have facilitated the World Healing Celebration on New Year's Eve morning during those years when we've been able to gather together right here at the center. It is my great pleasure to bring them up for you to share their wisdom and spiritual experiences with you this morning. So please welcome our practitioner and speakers in service this morning, Tina and Doug Bailey.
As your practitioner in service, I want to remind you that the practitioners are available to pray with you over the phone. If you do not have our phone numbers, please call the office and we'll have a practitioner call you back. And don't forget your prayer request button, which is on our website, so you can still send us your prayer requests. The confidential request goes directly to a practitioner, and we are still praying with you from our homes as we Zoom together at our usual time on Tuesday afternoons. Now it is time for song, silence, and prayer.
In this moment, I am love. Love is this moment. Love, love, love. This moment is what I am. In this moment, I am truth. Truth is this moment.
So as we take this opportunity to sit in the silence, in the quiet, turning within, knowing that we are absolutely divine, holy, precious, perfect beings, we know absolutely that this day and each day unfolds in perfection. For Spirit is with us, through us, operating for us and as us. And I give thanks for being here with you, and I give thanks for life itself. And so it is. Our reading today is from the book, Can We Talk to God? It's by Ernest Holmes. Consider the spirit as a warm, pulsating, reciprocal thing. It presses against us. It flows through us. It is our intelligence. It is a great universal urge and surge. It is a warm, colorful thing. It is a beautiful thing. Know that there is something more than law. An intelligence to which we may come for inspiration, for guidance, for direction, a power responding to us, a presence pressing against us, an animation flowing through us, and a light within us.
Jeremiah was a bullfrog. Was a good friend of mine. Never understood a single word he said, but I helped him drink his wine. And he always had somebody fine wine, singing joy to the world. All the boys and girls, joy to the fishes in the deep blue sea, joy to you and me.
Our title this morning is, Let's Go Fishing, which relates to a quote from Matthew where he says, feed a man a fish and you feed him for a day. Teach him how to fish, and you feed him for a lifetime. This indeed is the mission of all four chapters of The Science of Mind. And we are grateful for the opportunity each year to review the first four chapters of The Science of Mind. And this year we've added some timeless wisdom that fits right into the work that Ernest Holmes has done. Ernest Holmes said that this philosophy is the essence of simplicity, which presents a wonderful challenge to the January presenters as to how clearly we can explain this simple philosophy. Well, here goes. Let's look at where we've been this month. And we thought a great place to begin was to look at the religious science symbol, which serves as a wonderful visual aid to demonstrate the first three chapters. As you can see, it is a circle enclosing a descending V and divided into three parts. Reverend Bonnie began the month with chapter one, the thing itself, which talks about the top third, spirit, the divine, ultimate stuff, God. She talked about following the breadcrumbs, and that is spirit speaking to her with ideas and thoughts. She told us how her life experiences have included many of these powerful breadcrumbs, or the spirit knocks, if you want to call them that, how they appeared in front of her, and that when she followed them, they opened up new vistas for her and expanded her experiences. Lillianne introduced chapter two and her experiences with the way it works, how the thing itself interacts with law, and law is represented by the middle of the symbol. From her presentation, what I heard was how spirit speaks to her through her creativity, whether it is music or art or nature or in her body, as she spoke about the way it works. Chapter three, what it does, spirit descending through law and creating form, form illustrated by the bottom third of the symbol. That was covered by Jennifer Kleitz, as she spoke of her journey with spirit into following her inner desire for ministry and the path she is now on. All three of them demonstrate how listening to the still small voice within led them to where they are now. But don't worry, if you miss your own still small voice, or as we often do, choose to ignore it, don't worry. These spirit nudges are continuous, no limit. So simply put, our conscious mind expressing through our beliefs creates our experiences over and over. Try this. Think of an acorn. It does have within it the divine pattern of an oak tree. That seed, expressing through law, or the earth's nutrients and water, can become a mighty oak tree. The acorn's divine pattern is of an oak tree, so it cannot express as anything other. It cannot express as a corn plant, for example, or an apple tree. But what does this mean to us? Again, conscious mind expressing through our beliefs become our experiences or our own oak tree. A primary teacher friend of ours, Geneva, and fellow practitioner, always has a favorite way of explaining this. If you mix blue and yellow, you get a shade of green. And this is driven by law. If you want purple, you don't pray for purple and continue to mix only blue and green, blue and yellow. For a shade of purple, you need to change what you're doing, and you need to mix blue and red. You don't continue to mix blue and yellow and expect to see purple. This serves as a wonderful metaphor for the expression that we use in Science of Mind. Change your thinking, change your life, or its outcomes. So, if you want purple and you are getting green, or if you are getting something in your life other than what you want, change what you are doing and thinking. During our years here, we have learned many catchy phrases that helped anchor these ideas into our consciousness, two of which we still hear off and on today. The first is, treat and move your feet. This says that you pray for what you want, and then you take appropriate action toward that goal. You don't just pray and go about your business and never think of it again. Take the action appropriate for what your prayer is. Create your prayer, do your inner and outer work. And you might have noticed on the prayer requests used here at CSL, we put as a reminder a place for you to tell us that you understand this and what you are doing to support your prayer request when you send it to the prayer team. In other words, active and effective treatments are not passive. They require both thought and action. Our experiences are driven by cause and effect. We take action based upon belief, which is cause, and results in the experiences, which are their effect. This is true not only for individuals, but also for communities. As I said earlier, Holmes said this philosophy is the essence of simplicity. Doesn't it sound like that to you? He also said, in a given situation, one state of consciousness will determine one kind of result, another mental state, a very different manifestation. And the second popular phrase we still hear off and on, and in fact, Jennifer mentioned it in her talk in the metaphysical community about the teaching is, it helps you get princes, palaces, and parking spaces. What we have learned from that is, and it's changed over the years, we've learned that if you focus your attention, say you're driving, going to a store and you're driving in the parking lot and you keep saying over and over and you visualize to yourself that the perfect parking place opens up for you. You don't need to tell exactly what that perfect parking place is. You don't need to define it all the way, but just the knowingness is very powerful. And watch how that demonstration happens. What we've seen too is that many people come into this philosophy with a simple challenge in their lives, and they learn to face that challenge, to work through that challenge, and then they're satisfied and they go on. What has been powerful for us to watch, however, in our own lives and in the lives of many people that have gone through the classwork is, we can see how our visualization, our prayer work, and our doing the deep inner work, we can see that there are greater things possible for our lives once we understand and use these principles. Sometimes we might think it's too much work and just want to stop with these manifestations, but I challenge you today to take these principles deeper in your life. They are always available to us to use. Recognize and acknowledge the power within you when you see your demonstrations manifest in your life. Acknowledge your connection to spirit. As business people, we recognize a business's results are a reflection of a group's consciousness. The same is true not only of groups, but also of individuals. What it does is create an outpicturing of consciousness. In preparing this talk, it occurred to us that the life experiences that led each of us here are all different, yet resulted in a group with similar core beliefs who would fundamentally agree with Plotinus, a third century Greek philosopher, when he said, "There is within each of us a higher man or woman awaiting our recognition." I want you to take that into your consciousness. Through our lifetime, our paths are studded with a myriad of experiences, and special people come along who help us define our beliefs and the nature of our world. I think the first two chapters can be summed up wonderfully in Ernest Holmes' own words. the thing then works for us by working through us and is us always. That recognition often comes when someone comes into our lives who sees that greater person and reflects it back to us. Over the years, we have seen how powerful this is, and that is one of the roles and indeed one of the strongest gifts of Reverend Bonnie and this center. To see us, to see who we are, to see our potential, and to support us on our journey. Jesus said, "The kingdom of God is within." So, life truly is an inside God job, don't you think? Like the acorn, a pattern of perfection resides within each of us. We each have a spark of greatness awaiting our discovery. And as this new pattern unfolds, those people or things that are in alignment with this new pattern are attracted into our experience, and those who are not may vanish, and it's okay. We can draw from the universe as much as we can conceive and believe, no more. Wayne Dyer said it wonderfully, "I'll see it when I believe it." And now it's my great pleasure to introduce my wonderful husband and soulmate and fellow practitioner who keeps me on the track of knowing who I am, Doug Bailey.
I took a workshop with Tony Robbins, an impressive neuro-linguistic program trainer. What fascinated me about his workshop was his comment that if you understand the state of mind and belief of another person, which enables them to do something remarkable, you too can do it, as long as there is no physical or mental reason that limits you. He went on to say that was how he learned to firewalk. Let us imagine that we are standing on the edge of a pit with 2,000 degree coals and step into the coals and walk all the way the full 20 feet. Rephrasing Plotinus, there is within each of us the divine pattern of a giant awaiting our recognition. What steps do we need to take? What beds of coals do we need to walk through to recognize the power that we are? The firewalk is an excellent example of the power of the mind. And how can we change our mind about our limiting beliefs? Holmes reminds us that we are unfolding from a limitless potential, but can bring into our experiences only that which we can conceive. Emma Curtis Hopkins said, "I know today that the universe and this field of infinite possibilities are available to me and every living being." And of course, Napoleon Hill, "Whatever the mind can conceive and believe, it can achieve." Simply stated, that's what it does. Life is a reflection of our attitudes and beliefs, outpicturing in our experiences. The thing itself works for us by working through us and is us always. As much as we believe we will be able to do. How much can we accept? Instill into the mind the fundamental proposition that good is limitless. Go forth with faith, sow seeds, and be ready to reap the harvest. Simply stated, that's how to use it. Much of my early life, I created out of ignorance of who I was, ignorance of how life worked, ignorance of spiritual laws. I don't remember voting on the law, but there they are. I now know that even if I ignore them, deny them, or abuse them, they will become consequences. Which explains many unhappy experiences out of my past. Unhappy experiences can be a wake-up call, telling us we are out of harmony with the life we want. Benjamin Franklin clearly pointed out that out of adversity comes opportunity, an opportunity to reevaluate what really matters. Obstacles can be viewed as more an opportunity to step into a new life or our own greatness. Loss shows no favorites. If we mix blue and yellow, we'll get green. If we want purple, we better mix other colors. It is not that life is unfair, life is consistent. Will not violate its own laws, no matter how nicely we ask. This law tells us whatever appears in our life is an outpicturing of the beliefs we are holding. In leaving a negative relationship or job, if our basis in thought does not change, we will recreate the same situations again. We have choices. We can do things as we have always done them and with predictable results, or we can step outside our comfort zone into the unknown and tap the giant within. Remember Einstein's wonderful observation: the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different result. Who you are speaks so much louder than what you say. Our philosophy reminds us that at the core of our being resides the One. I know we can all act from this power. It is so easy to see the mistakes of the past and forget who we are, thus allowing our mistakes of the past to shape our experiences of the present and the future. Reverend Peggy Bassett reframes this in a wonderful way. Never make your past bad. It's part of who you are. In fact, it's a wonderful building block of your presence and future, therefore part of your strength. So the question for us is, can we get out of our own way? I know life is like a game, not a battle. It is played most successfully when we know the rules. We are captains of our fate, the arbiters of our soul, and the buck stops with each of us. So what are we? As we've learned, we are ultimate stuff expressing through universal law within the body of all that is, expressing as us. The thing itself is you, me, everything and everyone. Therefore, if I am one with it and you are one with it, then we are one with each other, everyone and everything. Which leads us very nicely to today's how to use it. If God is to express itself to us, it must express itself through us. It is the seed of the giant that is in each of us, the recognition of which will allow us to transform our beliefs and our experiences. Yesterday is part of our strength. Today can be a magnificent adventure exploring our potential. And tomorrow can be a giant revelation and a celebration of our life. Yesterday is history. Today is a gift. And tomorrow is a wonderful mystery. Still into our minds, the fundamental proposition that good is boundless. Go forth with faith and sow your seeds and be ready to not only reap the harvest, but metaphorically, let's go fishing and teach the hungry to fish. Please join us for a prayer. There is one power. I am one with this power. I am grateful for the lessons of the past and now embrace the realization that all of my experiences of my past are a source of strength, which serves me now. I release any thought about my past which does not support and empower me. I now recognize the pattern of perfection and seeds of greatness which grow within me. Nurtured by my growing awareness, flowering in the mirror of my experience, I am an expression of the power and the beauty of the One as I evolve and awaken to in the recognition of my connection to the One Source. For all that I am and the opportunity of self-realization which exists for me in each moment, I am grateful and I let it be. And so it is.
See, the dark night has come down on us. The world is living in its dream. But now we know that we can wake up from this sleep and set out on the journey. Find a ship, take us on the way. The time has come to trust that guiding light, leaving all the rest behind. We'll take the road that leads down to the water's side. Set out on the journey, find a ship, take us on the way, and we'll sail out on the water. Yes, we'll feel the seas roll. Yes, we'll meet out on the water. Dark night has come down on us. The world is living in its dream. But now we know that that we can wake up from this sleep. I set out on the journey, find a ship to take us on the way, and we'll sail out on the water.
I want to thank you again for joining us. Please stay safe. Please take to heart what you've heard this morning. It is an amazing way to change your life. Love you all.